independent in thought and punk rock in life. It's the Chad Benson Show.
They want to steal us! They want to steal us! And by that, I mean they want to take all of our info that we got on the internet. They want to sell it to other people. Should we allow that? No! I do not believe we should. That's just me, because you never know what's on your search history. Oh, you guys know what I'm talking about there. Joining us now is Caleb Watney. And Caleb, I appreciate you coming on today. I mean, you're a person who gets it. You understand this far more than I do. Give us a quick breakdown on exactly what these ISP providers want to do and how real it's going to be that people are going to be buying our, you know, our search engine history.
Yeah. Well, thanks for having me on the show, Chad. It's great to be here. So I think, first of all, it's good to sketch out what is the case and what is not the case. As is usual with these kind of internet privacy issues, there's been a lot of misinformation, you know, going around the internet and social media. So the first and most important thing to know is that there's not really any difference today than there was last week or even last year. If you weren't concerned about your privacy yesterday, you don't really have a lot more reason to be concerned today, because these Obama-era regulations that the FCC passed in October were scheduled to come into effect later on this year. And the Republican Congress, using the Congressional Review Act, basically stopped those regulations and didn't allow them to go into place. So we're pretty much stuck with the status quo that we had, you know, previously. And you can argue that that's a good thing or that's a bad thing, but if you weren't concerned before, you don't really have any more reason to be concerned now.
I've never been one of these people, Caleb, who worries anymore about my privacy. Because I think for most of us out there, we have given up our privacy along the way. We realize that our privacy is shot because we want to be a part of the world of the World Wide Web, and we put all of our information out there anyways. So I'm not that concerned, but it does frustrate me a little bit that, you know, I mean, you know, again, because data is king and information is king, and these guys are gathering data about us left, right, and center. I think I'm more worried about who they sell it to than whether or not they're gathering it.
Yeah. You know, that's definitely a thing to be concerned about. One of the things to be aware of with these regulations is, you know, the people that have the most data about you are going to be, you know, websites that you're on, like Facebook or Google. And these regulations didn't affect those companies at all. These regulations only narrowly targeted internet service providers. So that's, you know, Comcast, Verizon, whoever you get your internet through. But they are blocked from getting your data from any site that has HTTPS. If you look at the beginning of sort of the website that you're on, most websites today have those kind of safety functions, and that stops ISPs or makes it much more difficult for them to collect any data about that. So these regulations weren't even doing a good job of protecting your data, if that is what you're concerned about, because they were creating an uneven playing field, only applying certain things to internet service providers, but not to media companies like Google, Facebook, you know, et cetera. I think, you know, we can have hard conversations in our society about what we want our privacy to look like, but I think we can all agree that regardless of what we decide, it should be applied evenly across the board and not, you know, applied unevenly to some people and unfairly to others.
Now, you talk about, like, Google is a search engine in and of itself. So you type something into the search, it can get that data. Facebook's a little bit different because Facebook, you're captured inside of Facebook to a certain extent. Where, you know, the internet service provider, you've got your search history, and I think a lot of people are worried about, you know, them getting that information. We heard they could sell it to third party, they could sell it to other countries, and we're already inundated with all kinds of scam and spam, and I think that's the big thing. And let's be real, Caleb, I think we all understand that at some point in time, you're going to get breached, whether it be your Yahoo account or your AOL account or your bank account. At some point in time in your life, your adult life, you're going to get breached on these things. And I think just another fear is, okay, now you've given out our information to even more people.
Yeah. You know, that definitely can be a concern. Another thing to sort of to think about when you're evaluating different kind of regulations like this is, I think there's kind of this common misconception that advertisers can take your data specifically, your, you know, search history specifically. In fact, there was a really funny event kind of happening over the weekend where there were a bunch of leftist groups that were trying to crowdfund money on Kickstarter so that they could buy, quote-unquote, the web history for, you know, popular Republican politicians like Donald Trump and Ajit Pai, the commissioner of the FCC, and Mitch McConnell. But that just betrays a total misunderstanding of how these systems work. When advertisers are getting your data from companies like Facebook and Google, they're not getting your Chad Benson's information. It's all anonymized, you know. So Facebook says these are the kinds of things that 30 to 50 year olds who live in, you know, Iowa are interested in, and then you know, they can get a little bit more narrowed down from there. But it's not information specifically, it's about you. It's about broad information about your demographics. And when you have more targeted information like that, it's more useful for advertisers, and hopefully it should be more useful for you as an individual. I know just the other day, you know, through some Facebook ads, I was able to find a really nice pair of shoes that, you know, I had been looking for, and the ads brought them right to me. So in an ideal world, ads aren't something to be scared of. They're a useful way of finding new information. And so, you know, I think we have to be careful about, you know, the types of information that are and aren't being given out. But when we think about what do we want the ideal system to look like, it's not that there's no advertising or that you have complete privacy, because, you know, let's face it, there's a lot of really cool free services that we get online. Facebook, YouTube, Gmail, these are all really useful to a lot of people, and they're free because of advertising. And I know I wouldn't want to pay for Facebook, and I doubt, you know, most people would. So I think, you know, in some ways we have to make trade-offs, and we have to recognize that advertising is a useful service when done correctly.
Absolutely. Talking to Caleb Watney, a tech policy associate at R Street Institute. You talk about the fact that these were Obama era policies that were supposed to go in place. They're not going in place. What else was supposed to go in place that we wouldn't have, you know, that may have affected us that didn't go into? Because I know there was more than just this.
So within this bill, most of it was targeted at internet service providers, and it would have changed sort of the opt-in versus opt-out default option for consumers. But this was kind of the main function that was getting a lot of pushback. Also, I wanted to mention, I think another important facet of this debate is that, you know, just because these regulations got repealed doesn't mean that, you know, now internet service providers are free to do whatever they want. There's still lots of other cops on the beat. And in fact, the federal agency that's been managing privacy for over 30 years now is the Federal Trade Commission. And I think, you know, when you talk to experts in cybersecurity and advertising, most of them will say that the Federal Trade Commission has a lot better of a record of properly managing consumers' privacy rights, but also recognizing, you know, the important business need for advertising. And through the repeals of these regulations, I think, you know, we're trying to return power back to the FTC, because they're the proper cop on the block that should be managing this, not the FCC.
Caleb, if we look forward, I hear all this stuff, and look, I like I said, I know that I've surrendered my privacy, first of all, by doing the show and doing what I do and doing my comedy stuff. I surrendered a monicum of my privacy. I get that. Doing the things that we do with putting our, you know, everything in the world out there for the world to see, we get a little bit of that. But let's say there are people out there that only want to do a little bit of Facebook and that only want to do a little bit of this. They're all, you know, there's always a worry of something. Is there stuff that we can do extra? You know, because we're hearing of the Android phones, all these phones now have, you know, special cookies and malware on there that's going to do everything for you. Is there anything we can do as a consumer that will protect us to a certain extent, just in case? Because I know it all starts out with, we're only going to do this, but then we find out 5 years later, oh, but by the way, we did this.
Yeah. No, you're right. There are absolutely steps that consumers can take to try and, you know, make their web browsing more secure. And for privacy-conscious consumers, there's lots of options that you can use. So, you know, to clear up another misconception, you might have heard sometimes on the internet that by browsing in sort of private modes on, say, Google Chrome or Internet Explorer, you can block, you know, ISPs from collecting your data. That is not true. That doesn't really stop us. I wouldn't recommend that. The best thing that you can do is actually to get a virtual private network, a VPN. And if you just Google that, you know, you can find lots of options. They usually range to be, you know, a couple bucks to $10 a month on average. And basically what that does is it sort of hides where your browsing history is coming from, and the internet service provider can't tell, you know, who's searching for what, and it scrambles all the data. And so, you know, if you're really safety conscious and privacy conscious, I'd say that's probably the best tool you can use to make yourself more safe and more private.
Last question, Caleb, and we'll let you go. Looking forward, let's look out 12 months, 24 months. Where do you see internet protection going for the consumer? Where do you see us as consumers, you know, starting to fear, you know, who's going to be getting into to what? Because I'm telling you, as much as I'm about free market, I don't trust a lot of these people when it comes to the free market. So as a consumer, what should we be worried over the next 12 to 24 months as far as them collecting our data and what they're doing with it?
Yeah, so the next step to kind of look at is where does it go from here? Because this is only one part of the conversation. This isn't the end. So from here, you know, there's a number of steps. The FCC could try to have more fair, more even-handed regulations that they could pass through that affect everyone across the board equally, not just internet service providers. And if they did attempt to, you know, pass some sort of regulation like that, I think that would be a much more fair way of doing it. Or what I think the best solution would be to return jurisdiction over this issue to the Federal Trade Commission. Because again, you know, they're the ones with all the experience, they're the ones with, you know, the long history of managing consumers' privacy rights. And you're right, you know, sometimes you should be concerned, and especially in areas where there's not a lot of broadband competition, you know, sometimes there are things to be concerned about, and carefully managed regulation can be a good force. But we want to make sure that it is carefully managed, and I think the Federal Trade Commission is probably the best cop to do that.
His name is Caleb Watney, the Tech Policy Associate at R Street Institute. We appreciate you coming on today and talking about that and clearing up some of the stuff that's true and some of the stuff that people just overreacted on. We do appreciate that, man. Look forward to talking to you soon.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me on.
Thanks. Again, we know they gather our data. My issue is, who are they selling it to? That's a bigger issue. I mean, and yes, they're not going to do it individually. You're not going to go and say, oh, I'd like to find out what Anthony or what Phil or what Chad is doing. But because you're buying in bulk and you're buying, it sounds great when it's a consumer side thing. But as we all know, that doesn't always end up to where it is, right? It starts somewhere and then ends up somewhere else. 844-DIG-CHAD, 844-344-2423, chat@chadbensonshow.com. You can text the program, 323-538-2423, 323-538-2423. It's the Chad Benson Show.